Welcome to Art Business with Ness. I'm Ness and I'm a children's book illustrator. I always receive a lot of questions from you guys, so I decided it would be cool to do a Q&A today to address every question that you really want to know about. So I asked in my Facebook group, the Freelance Illustrators Cafe, if you guys had any questions for the Q&A video, and boy, you guys delivered. I received so many, in fact, that I'm going to have to split this into two parts. So today, welcome to part one of Ask a Professional Illustrator. Right before we jump into the questions, I just wanted to give you a little news and update real quick. So you may remember a few weeks ago, I posted a video about the three art courses topics that I was thinking of doing, and I asked for your opinion about which one you would like me to make. The results are now in, and overwhelmingly, the response has been that you want me to make the Art Business Bootcamp. So the Art Business Bootcamp was the big program that will contain information about how to become a freelance illustrator from literally zero all the way to professional full-time illustrator. It will go into all the nitty-gritty of everything that you need to do on the business side to make the right decisions and start your career like a rocket. I was actually really surprised that this was the course that won. I thought that the least expensive course, Level Up Your Art, was gonna win, but you guys really want to know about art business. I respect that. Art Business Bootcamp is very close to my heart. It's the first course idea that I ever had, and I think this is gonna be a bomb course. So if you're interested in just hearing about it for the first time now, I'm actually going to leave a link to the waiting list in the comments below. You can still join, and if you're interested in this course, you're really gonna wanna be on this waiting list, because people on this list are gonna have the opportunity to pre-order the course when it first comes out at 50% off. So instead of $1,000, you will have the chance to get the course at $497, which is insane discount, and you won't want to miss it. So link in the description for the waiting list if you want to get on that. But now let's get to the questions. First question, Lynn asks, what are the tools needed to get started with illustration? I wasn't sure if I should buy a Wacom Intrus or Apple Pencil. Since I already had an iPad, I went with the Apple Pencil. Now I need to figure out software needed and how to integrate with Photoshop. Okay, so I personally use a desktop computer with a large Wacom Intuos. This right here, it's an Intuos Pen & Touch 5. I do all of my art on my desktop station. I have a really nice little setup with two monitors and a really nice comfy chair. So this is really what has been optimal for me personally, but of course everyone is different, and I know so many people that love working on their iPad. Now, the mobile version of Photoshop isn't really that good. It's nowhere near the desktop version. So I would really suggest, if you're on the iPad, to go with Procreate or Affinity Designer. Procreate especially, I've heard nothing but good things about. It's an amazing software that's really intuitive and fun to use. Sadly for me, I've found that it kind of hurts my neck to be drawing on the iPad for several hours a day. And since drawing is my full-time job, I really have to find a setup that allows me to draw comfortably for several hours on end. But of course, just because it doesn't work for me, doesn't mean that it won't work for you. There are many different things that you can try to improve the ergonomics. There's iPad stands that you can use, or arms. So those sort of things are really worth looking into. But yeah, definitely when you're thinking about your setup, think of not just the software, but also how comfortable it is going to be for your body. Next one, Michael. I actually really like this one because it's not really a question. Michael says, you should tell your audience what the warning signs of a bad agent are. Unrealistic deadlines, pleasing the clients, asking you, the illustrator, to pay them, almost no work for an entire year, etc. Sure thing, Michael. So here are some red flags. It is definitely bad if the agent asks you to pay them for anything, whether it is a promotional booklet, the stamps, whatever. The agent is supposed to be the one to pay you. The money should always flow from them to you. Never the other way around. Also, another thing to look out for, the agent has to be willing to work with you to answer any questions that you have. That's their job. So if you're not even signed yet and they're acting impatient with you or don't want to answer your questions when you're discussing about the contracts or when you're voicing your concerns, that's a really bad sign. However, some of the other things you mentioned aren't necessarily, you know, automatic red flags though. Like pleasing the client. Of course, the agent is gonna wanna please the client, and probably you will too. And for things like unrealistic deadlines, you know, the agent and the client for that matter may not realize that they're unrealistic deadlines. They don't know how long it takes you to do your work. Different artists have different methods that take different amount of time. So if your agent sends you a job that has an unrealistic deadline, I think it's your responsibility to just tell them that you need more time. Same thing for receiving no work from your agent for a long period of time. Communicate with them. Ask them if there's a problem and what you can do to get more work. We sometimes imagine that when working with an agent, everything will be perfect all of the time. When in reality, it's still possible, even with an agent, that there will be issues that arise from time to time, and you need to communicate. Every once in a while, my agent sends me a job that has a really short deadline, and I just tell them, oh, you know, this is a really interesting job and the pay is good, but I can't do it in that period of time. And often they will just tell me, oh, I didn't realize, sure thing, I will ask the client for more time. And it's no big deal. In general, I really find it best to not assume malice right from the get-go. Most of the time, people just don't know. And they won't know it's a problem unless you tell them. Use your words. Let everyone know what you need if you want to get it. Next question. If you have to give your agency the PSD files with all the layers, do you need to organize and label each layer a specific name to make it easier? And is that considered more professional for your agency? Actually, there's absolutely no reason for your agency to ever request PSD files. They won't be asking for that. In fact, if they ask you for your PSD files, I might consider that a red flag. Even clients very rarely request original unflattened PSDs. They need to have a real legitimate reason to ask for that. If they do have a legitimate reason, then of course, when you send them a PSD, make sure it's not a mess. Label each layer, put them into folders, make sure that it's easy to navigate. That's just, you know, being polite and making sure that your work isn't a complete mess. But most of the time, you'll be sending your clients a flattened file with no layers at all, so it doesn't come up really that often. Next, Annalise asks, I would love to know your thoughts on how to email your portfolio to art directors. What do you write in the email? How many pictures and what pictures should you include? I get a lot of questions about how to query art directors, especially a lot of questions about what to write in the email itself. And I really think that most of y'all are slightly overthinking it. The email itself really doesn't matter all that much. It's all about your portfolio, really. Just make the query email short because art directors are really busy. Mention just your relevant experience and add a little personal touch if you can. And then have a clear link to your portfolio right at the top. That's really all that you need. As for pictures to include, I really suggest to look at their company's website to see if there's any guidelines on that subject. Sometimes they will mention something like attach 3 small resolution JPEGs or something like that. Personally, unless they expressly request pictures attached to email, I don't attach any at all. It can really easily blow up people's email inboxes when you attach pictures. Just imagine if every single query they get is full of huge images, it really will go through their storage very fast. Also, something else to consider, emails with picture attachments can even sometimes end up in spam. So I don't think it's really worth risking it. Unless they specifically ask for it, I personally don't attach any pictures at all. Your portfolio is only one click away anyway, so it's not that big a deal. Next, how many times a year do you email art directors with new work? As many as 3 or 4 times a year is okay. Of course, it can be less, but no more than 4, I would say. Like, once every 3 months, I think that's as much as you can get away with. And of course, only email them if you actually have new work to show them. Don't just keep emailing them the same old portfolio over and over again, because you won't get a different answer than all the other times. What is the best way to make new work that you can send to art directors, and how to motivate yourself, set yourself deadlines to make it, etc.? I don't think there's any one way that's the best or right way to stay motivated. I can only speak to what works for me personally. I always end up including a lot of my professional pieces in emails that I send to art directors because I don't always have time to make a lot of personal pieces. If I do have time to make a personal piece, then often I will go over my portfolio and see if I can find a hole, something I'm not covering. For instance, I know that right now I don't have a black and white illustration in my portfolio, so next time I have the time to make a personal piece, that's probably what I'm going to do. I'll also look over the themes and stories that I'm already covering in my portfolio and try to see if there's something new that I could do to add some variety. And lastly, I'll often go to Pinterest and search a wide variety of things, paintings, illustrations, sculptures, architectures, all over the place to get inspiration, to try to get those creative juices flowing. The best way for me to stay motivated to work on a piece is to find something that really, really excites me, a topic that just makes me so eager to work on it that I just jump out of bed in the morning to get to it. And by the way, if you're working on your portfolio right now, I actually have a free portfolio checklist that maybe will give you some inspiration. It's specifically tailored to children's books illustration and it's completely free, as I said, so I will leave the link to go get that in the description below. Next, Lenin asks, is it better to have only one art style or no multiple? And if you want to change art styles, how do you start? Great question. I have noticed that both art directors and agents really do want to see a signature style and they want to see some consistency. From my own experience, I've also noticed that when you can draw in many different styles, clients also tend to treat you kind of like a commodity and you tend to attract a lot more lower ticket offers that are not as well paid. Whereas having a signature style is kind of like having a calling card, something that you will be known for, your specialty. You kind of become the expert, the go-to person when someone needs that kind of work, and I do notice that this tends to attract higher paying jobs in general. However, just because you choose a signature style now doesn't mean that you have to stick with it for the rest of your life. Many artists are really afraid to pick a style because they take the decision a little bit too seriously and they are afraid to commit. And I really want to stress that you can change your mind. You can do a style for a few years and then take stock and decide if that still works for you. I'm actually right in the middle of changing my own style myself right now. For the last 3 years or so, I've really been focusing on this very clean and commercial looking vector style, very cute. However, I've noticed that my taste has started changing and now I'm much more interested in more textured, organic and loose sort of styles that look a bit more wild. My cute vector style has also pegged me for the younger market of books such as baby books and board books, but now I would really like to expand my horizons and try the typical 32-page picture book. It's a little bit of an older market, so my current style wouldn't work for that. So right now what I've done is I've done a lot of experimenting. I've did several tests for what this new style could look like. I really want to incorporate some watercolors, some coloring pencils. So I've been playing around. And recently I finally found one that I really want to commit to for the next few years. So I'm currently in the process of building a whole new portfolio around that style. It is a long process, but I think it's worth it. Next, Jess asks, hey, I wondered whether it's normal for agents to ask to see more work or ask for you to create an entirely new piece after you've already submitted to them. It depends on the agent or the situation, but it is not abnormal. Usually, your portfolio will be very restricted. It will have between 12 to 20 pieces of work, which when you think about it, isn't really all that much. It's just the best of the best. But an agent, before they want to sign you, they may want to see like your whole body of work. So they may want to see 30 to 40 pieces in total so they can really aptly judge your ability before deciding to sign you. You don't put all of this in your portfolio, but they still may request to see it before making their final decision. And if there's a major hole in your portfolio, something that's a really important skill that you're not demonstrating, then they may even request that you do a whole new piece to see if you're able to do that. For instance, let's say you have a gorgeous portfolio, but you don't show any human characters at all into it. And they think that in the market that you're going for, that you're really gonna have to draw humans. And they may ask you to create a piece with a human character to see if that's something that you're even able to do before making their final decision. Next question, Lynn asks, do you have any tips or any resources to refer to when drafting your own contract? Good questions. Contracts can be so difficult. I know it's something that many are not comfortable with at all. I don't currently have a specific resource for that, but I am working on it. I'm currently writing the script for my upcoming online course, the Art Business Bootcamp, and there's a whole section in there about contracts, and it will include a contract template, as well as what I like to call a clause bucket, where you can pick and choose which clauses you want to add into your template. It is really hard work to prep something like this, but I think in the long run, you will find it very helpful, so I think it's worth it to make this resource. I also think I'll be using it all the time for making my own contracts. Next, Maxmel asks, have you tried selling prints of your work? If so, how did that go? I have sold prints at many different times throughout my career and in college, and it never really went that well for me, to be honest. During college, I had an Etsy shop that sold a bunch of different things. I had prints and original on there, and I have a bunch of weird things too, like handmade notebooks and painted shoes. It was all over the place. I never actually did any marketing, so the success was very limited. I sold maybe 20 prints for the several years that it was open. Then years later, when I started freelancing full-time, I made a line of nursery prints and I opened an Etsy shop for that. It was a line of black and white nursery prints, which I really had thought of pretty thoroughly. But there was holes in my marketing in there. I really wasn't targeting the right client for this. So I sold maybe 10 prints in total. Don't let my experience with prints deter you. If you do it right, unlike me, there's no reason that you wouldn't have success. So go for it. Next, Nash asks, this is not art business related, but who are your favorite illustrators? Oh, thank you for this question. I love to geek out about my favorite illustrators. So right now, I really like Isabelle Arsenault. You can find her on Instagram at Isabelle_Arsenault. I also really love and admired Leon Hatch, who you can find on Insta at LeonHatch_illustration. And lastly, one of my all-time favorites is Rebecca Green, the amazing Rebecca Green, which you can find at Rebecca Green Illustration on Instagram. I love their wild, loose, messy, traditional looking styles. It's to die for. So that's finally it for all of the questions that we got this round. Thank you so much for everyone who asked questions. I will certainly make another Q&A video in the future. So if you happen to have any questions and don't hesitate, go drop them in the comments below. I will keep them preciously for a future video. But for right now, that's it for me today. Thank you so much for being here and for watching this video. I hope you liked it and you found it helpful. If you did, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to help our small channel grow. Thank you so much for being here. Love you. Bye bye.